write the test here, right on the stage in front of you. And we wrote the Bible in that startup, and we wrote the Bible in marketing. So we're lucky to have you here, guys. Let's start at the beginning. See, one of the best ways to define what something is, in your case, in the startup technique, is to define what it's not. The one thing it most definitely is not, it's a business plan. So, what are the business plans?
Yeah, so one of the things we figured out after 50 years of doing entrepreneurship in Silicon Valley, doing startups, is that, get ready for it, startups aren't smaller versions of large companies. Now, that might seem intuitively obvious, but for 50 years, investors in Silicon Valley and elsewhere said to startups that you do everything our companies do. They write a business plan, you write a business plan. They write a five-year forecast, we want you to write a five-year forecast. They hire sales, marketing, biz dev, we want you to do that, and they build products with waterfall engineering, you do. And, you know, we did that, and like, we were kind of surprised that after we launched the product, we used to think the biggest problem we were going to have is we have a big enough office to put all the bags of money that were going to come on day one. And we were all surprised that that didn't happen. And the reason why is no business plan survives first contact with customers. It turned out that we were using a methodology that was perfect for large corporations, but we had no tools at all that actually made sense. But instead of executing a series of knowns like in a large company, we were dealing with a series of unknowns, which were what a startup was. And so myself, Eric Reese, and Alexander Osterwalder, and then later, of course, put together this idea called the lean startup, which is very, very, very different from how to write a business.
All right, good. We'll hold it there for a second. So I'm going to put the same question to you. What is growth hacking? And how is growth hacking different from what everyone thinks of when they think of marketing?
Okay, so marketing is something that's been around for a really long time, and it starts with this annual marketing plan, and it's based on kind of a set of channels that don't change a whole lot over time, and all of us know that channels change really quickly today. And so growth hacking is really, it's not that annual planning cycle that marketing is. It goes in weekly sprints. It's a process of testing and figuring out what's going to work, kind of week to week, monitoring that, taking advantage of the data feedback loops, really learning when something works, doubling down on it. And so it's not annual planning cycles, it's not awareness building. A lot of marketing is about awareness building. We used to have startups all the time say, can you come and help us build awareness for our startup? You don't have budgets close to being big enough to build awareness. Focus on sustainable customer acquisition with a return on investment, and just keep cycling money based on that, and you'll build awareness over time through experiences. So that's on the contrast of marketing. It's also, there's a lot of like misunderstandings with growth hacking. It's not some magic bag of hacks that you can just apply in any business. It's actually more of a process of testing and figuring out what's going to work. And those are probably the biggest definers of what's not.
Steve, when I think of the kind of the pillars of the lean startup technique, I think of three things. I think of except that the business model is a hypothesis, that you have to get out of the building and talk to customers, and you need to practice agile build techniques.
You
need to explain this.
So it turns out that how many of you are passionate founders? Come on. How many of you believe you're visionaries? Come on, raise your hand. So the good news is, most of you are hallucinating. The bad news is, we don't know which one. And the lean startup methodology is just a way to figure out whether you're hallucinating or you're a visionary without spending lots of time and money to do so. The lean methodology starts with, even though you truly believe on day one, you understand customers' problems, and all you need to do is build that app, or ship that product, or get that hardware out, and a thousand money will come in. Lean says that's not how the world works. Lean says that all you have on day one is a series of untested hypotheses, and I use the word hypotheses at Stanford because my students pay $50,000 a year and want to hear big words. But outside of Stanford, it just means you're after guessing. You're guessing about who your customers are, what the channel is, what product market fit, that is, what features should go with what customers, what's the pricing, what are the other pieces you need. You're mostly just guessing. And the way we need to solve that is let's build the product, let's ship it, and then we'll find out later if someone's buying it, we'll be able to create an end. And that's okay if you have infinite time, money, resources, and patience. But Lee says there's now a much better way to do that. Why don't we just simply break down what all those hypotheses are? What are the pieces you need to know to build a successful company? Alexander Osterwalder wrote a book called Business Model Generation, and he got all these complex ideas down into a single piece of paper with 9 boxes on it called Business Model Canvas. Go on, read it. We basically write down your hypothesis. This includes the part I invented that says, guess what? There are no facts inside your building, so get the hell outside. Because there's no possible way to be smarter than the collective intelligence of potential customers, and stakeholders, and regulators, or depending on your businesses. And step 3 is our research contribution that says, why are we building our product serially? Why don't we build our product incrementally and iteratively, testing each one of those hypotheses with what's called a minimum viable product? And most of the time, we're going to find out that we're wrong about some part of our business. We got the wrong customer segment, we got the wrong pricing, maybe feature 3 should be feature 1, or these other 6 features aren't needed. Lean says we're allowed to be wrong because we can do something called a pivot. And a pivot is defined as a substantive change to one or more of those business model hypotheses. We got something wrong. But instead of spending money or firing the VP of sales or firing the head of engineering, we simply fire the plan before we fire the people. What's your question?
So, GrowthHackers sounds to me like lean applied to customer acquisition and marketing. But you have a concept that I found really attractive, and the image is really cool, a flywheel of growth. Can you explain that?
That ultimately, over time, as you're very similar. You have a hypothesis, you're testing the hypothesis. The more tests you run per week, the more you're going to figure out ways to grow the business. Many of them aren't going to work, some of them will, and over time you start to build momentum in the business, and that gives you that flywheel over time of, generally, if what you're optimizing for is a great experience with your product, so growth hacking is not just about external customer acquisition, but it's really about the full funnel, running those experiments through customer acquisition, activation, retention, engagement, everything that drives an experience with the product, that unlocks word of mouth, that unlocks a lot more of the pieces that really drive organic growth, which complements all of the tactics that you're figuring out over time.
So give me an example of companies.
So Dropbox. Huge part of Dropbox. Everybody looks at Dropbox and they think, it's got this natural virality with the sharing that we have with folders or with files. And yes, all of those things were important, yet why is there the number one source of new users was through just natural word of mouth. People were really excited about it. They loved the experience. They told other people about it.
When people try to put lean startup techniques into effect, what do they get wrong most often?
Well, what they get wrong is, okay, I sold 3 customers, I'm done. Lean is hard, not because anything technically is hard, but it creates cognitive dissonance with founders who believe, let me just build the darn thing, get it out the door, and magic will happen. It's a lot harder to kind of emotionally say, no, even though I believe, let me test a piece of it, or some of it, or some of my assumptions. And so there's nothing hard technically, but key for you to get some relevant data, you need to be talking personally to, at minimum, 10 customers a week. And if you're doing a web or mobile app, if you don't have data points from a couple of thousand customers, don't even bother to call lean. Call it what it is. If we're against the wall, we'll see if something happens. And that's okay, because there's nothing religious about lean. And you're hearing it from me. It's not a religion. It's not the way to do startups. It happens to be the most efficient way we have right now, but no one's going to run in and kind of smack you on the side of the head, unless you're taking one of my classes. That's just they're doing it wrong. It's just that there's now thousands of teams been through this, who will raise their hand and say, boy, is it painful, but we probably saved years, if not more, and millions of dollars doing startups this way.
You saw one of the bolder statements you made is that lean can prevent or at least reduce the high failure rate of startups. But that's always seemed to be part of the risk you take.
Startups have a huge infant mortality rate for just this reason. Because, again, the passion of an entrepreneur, I mean, what drives most of you to work insane hours, quit real jobs, you know, tell your family, like, you don't see them anymore, like, or whatever. That passion creates its own reality distortion field. You have to be the first true believer. And sometimes that reality distortion field blinds yourself to the fact that it is a religion with you, not there's no data. And so what we're trying to create is evidence-based entrepreneurship. So, and the difference is, and with all due respect to the people who've been pitching today, you know, when you do a pitch and all you say is, here's my product, here's how smart I am, and here's how big it is, that's a content-free presentation that when I'm an investor, I'm saying, did I like the font? Because you gave me no data. What I really want to hear is, what did you think 4 months ago? What did you believe about customers? What did you believe about product market fit? What did you learn in the last 4 months on your nickel? And if the answer is nothing, then like, I'm not going to be the first dumb investor. There's plenty of dumb money out there that I'm sitting in this audience. I'm interested in your velocity and trajectory of learning, whether it's users or scale or just data or feedback or something, that you've got smarter, because it doesn't cost you any money to get smarter. It just costs you some discipline. And when people say that entrepreneurship is not discipline, I don't know what they're running, but in lean, it is the most disciplined profession there is. Lean startups bring evidence and discipline to entrepreneurship along with growth hacking.
Yeah, for sure. And if I could just follow on one thing, is that one of the biggest differences between lean startup and growth hacking is that lean startup is the full life cycle of the business. Growth hacking is irrelevant until you have product market fit. If you have not validated that you've created value in the first place, you're just spinning your wheels if you're trying to acquire customers into an experience where they're not getting real value.
And remember, product market fit is just simply what it sounds like. Who are your customers and what parts of the product that you thought they would like, do they really like? And if you can't find that fit, then keep looking. Don't just keep shipping a product. You're actually looking for who's the right customer segment, right market, right pricing, right whatever. And when you find it, that's the magic thing called product market fit, and then growth hacking can happen. Eric.
I wanted to push on the question I put to you earlier. When people think they're doing growth hacking and what they're really doing is just hacking, what are they doing? What are they getting wrong?
So one thing is that they would just be kind of randomly doing tests. They're just doing a bunch of things rather than stepping back and having a clear hypothesis or guess of what's going to happen when I do this, and having a process of figuring out what am I going to do first, what am I going to do second, how do I act on the learning that I've gotten from the previous tests that I've run. How do I organize that information so that I get smarter over time and start, when you start to see signal in a channel or in referral loops or whatever it might be that's driving growth in your business, that you double down in that area and you work that vein of gold until you start to flatten out and get those diminishing returns, and then you work somewhere else. So I think that's one of the mistakes that people make, is that they're just randomly doing some things. And most of the people, when you ask them how many tests have you run, they're going to be totally off on what the actual numbers are. They'll think that they're running 10, 20 tests a month, when in fact they're actually running 3 tests per month, because it's just a very undisciplined process. So that when you hold someone accountable to document the number of tests you're running, capture that learning, it becomes a lot more disciplined process, but it's one that becomes additive over time and starts to go quick.
Yeah, so if you're right, just thinking about what Sean just said, lean startup and growth hacking is about 500 years old. That is, what we just reinvented is the scientific method. That is, if you think of the scientific method, how we do science worldwide is we have a hypothesis, we design an experiment, we run the experiment, we get some data, we derive some insight, and we either validate, invalidate, or refine that hypothesis. And that's a loop. That's what makes lean startup and growth hacking incredibly efficient. It truly is not just like, you know, pray and spray a set of products out there. There's a methodology that, again, 500 years of running it, we seem to have found more efficient than other things to do. But again, it's counter to the passion of I just want to do it. And that's what makes discipline in lean.
I can't let you get off stage without asking you about what Lean is doing now. One of the, what you just said about basically is as applicable to all kinds of business and all kinds of other things as the scientific method. And lately, you've been applying it to the defense department. Tell us about that.
So, as most of you know, at least in the U.S. and worldwide, we're facing threats for security and safety that are happening at speed that normal governments don't have in their planning cycles. In the U.S., we don't have fire aircraft carriers for 2 decades, and F-35 fighter planes that take a couple decades, but when ISIS shows up and is able to move in days, weeks, and hours, and we're still writing the acquisition plan, there's kind of a mismatch. Turns out the Lean methodology has actually been great just to start thinking about how to solve some of these safety and security problems for not just Americans, but others around the world. And so we started a version of a Lean Launchpad class that had been adopted in the U.S. by all our science research, the National Science Foundation, National Institute of Health, adopted the Lean methodology to commercialize all science in the United States around 5 years. The Department of Defense is now adopting Lean methodology. We have a class called Hacking for Defense, which uses that and is beginning to provide solutions for safety and security around the world.
Speak for a lot of people here, I find that really reassuring.
Well, we'll see. Our adversaries are using Lean, and so we just need to catch up with
them. Oh, yes. Yeah. In fact, I understand that it's some captured ISIS documents. There was some of your work.
I can neither confirm nor deny. So now I'm just feeling incredibly guilty. And if you want to see the class, go to steamlink.com and see a weekly blog. But there are also large corporations are now using Lean as well. Eric Ries kind of pioneered this with Beth Comstock at GE. But every large corporation is, as you know, being disrupted and trying to adopt the Lean methodologies as well. So it's not just for startups, it's for every type of business we have.
Sean, you talked a bit about this question when we were out in the lobby. Growth hacking is really hard for established companies to pick up. Why?
Mostly because it's a cultural change, and it's one where marketing teams are used to running experiments and getting that data feedback loop and working pretty quickly. Product teams usually haven't worked at that same pace of experimentation and using data to make decisions. But marketing teams are not trusted, probably for good reason, deeper in the product. And so for driving retention and engagement and conversion, you have that's kind of no man's land where marketing's sort of approach is not welcome there. And so there's a lot of cultural changes in trying to figure out who actually manages this. And the companies that are doing it well tend to have growth teams that sit in the product organization. And they're managing cross-functionally, coordinating efforts with marketing and engineering and product, but it's hard. I mean, that in bigger companies, and I can tell you that our Growth Hackers conference a couple of months ago, Target sent a lot of people to it. Google sent more people than any organization there. Microsoft and IBM and others are really trying to work it. And I think they'll figure it out, but it's just not easy.
All right, last question, philosophical and inspirational note. See, at the top of your homepage, it says, entrepreneurship is a calling. What do you mean?
Well, jobs are great. Normal people have jobs. But founders are called. If you want a job, you should go get one. It's great, 9 to 5, there's security and whatever. But entrepreneurship is not a job. Maybe thinking you have a job, you ought to actually get a real one. But this is the best calling you could ever have. It's the most exciting journey you're going to be on. So make sure you're signed up to become one.
All right. Thank you, guys. Thanks, Steve. Thank you.